story begins, that the women...
Of whom there were several in the crowd, the woman prepared to take peculiar interest in whatever penile affliction might be expected to ensue for Hester Prynne,
who stood on the scaffold,
an infant in her arms,
and the letter A in scarlet, fantastically embroidered on her bosom. Good wives, I give thee a piece of my mind. It would be well for the public behoof if we women had the handling of such malefactresses as this Hester Prynne. What think ye, gossips?
People say that the Reverend Master Dimmesdale, her godly pastor, takes it very grievously to heart that such a scandal should have come upon his congregation.
We should have put a brand of hot iron on Hester Prynne's forehead.
Let her cover the mark as she will. Not a pang of it will be in her heart.
What is this talk of marks and brands? This woman has brought shame upon us all and ought to die. Is there not law for it?
Make way, good people, make way in the king's name. Come along, Madam Hester. Show your scarlet letter in the marketplace.
I pray you, good sir, who is this woman? And wherefore is she in setup to public shame?
She will cause a great scandal in godly Master Dimmesdale's church.
Would it please you to tell me of Hester Prynne? Have I her name rightly? Of this woman's offenses and what has brought her to yonder scaffold?
Yonder woman was the wife of a certain learned man, and his young wife, looky, being left to her as
a... I conceive you. And who, by your favor, sir, may be the father of yonder babe, which Mistress Prynne is holding in her arms?
That matter remains a riddle. Madam Hester absolutely refuses to speak.
The learned man should come himself to look into the mystery.
Her husband may be at the bottom of the sea.
Therefore, they have not been bold to put in the force the extent of our own righteous law against her.
The penalty of her crime is death.
But in their great mercy and tenderness, they have doomed Mistress Prynne to stand only a space of 3 hours on the platform.
And then and thereafter, for the remainder of her natural life, to wear a mark of shame upon her bosom.
A wise sentence. It irks me, nevertheless, that the partner of her iniquity should not at least stand on the scaffold by her side. But he will be known. He will be known. He will be known.
Hearken unto me, Hester Prynne. I have striven with a young brother here, under whose preaching of the word you have a privilege to sit. What say you to it once again, Brother Dimmesdale? The responsibility for this woman is solved by strength with you. Speak to the woman.
Exhort her to confess the truth.
Hester Prynne, I charge thee to speak the name of thy fellow sinner and fellow sufferer.
What can thy silence do for him?
Speak out the name, that in thy repentance may have able to take scarlet letter off thy breast.
Never! It is too deeply branded. He cannot take it off. And would that I might endure his agony. As well as mine.
Speak, woman, speak! Give your child a father.
I will not speak. And my child must seek a heavenly father. She shall never know an earthly one.
She will not speak. Wondrous strength and generosity of a woman's heart, she will not speak.
I pray thee, friends, leave me alone with my patients. You shall find Mistress Prynne hereafter more amenable to just authority than you may have found her heretofore.
Nay, your worship can accomplish that. Shall all you from a man of skill and need.
My old studies in alchemy have made a better physician of me than many that hold a medical degree. Here, woman. This child. child is yours, she is none of mine. And neither will she recognize my voice or aspect as a father. Therefore, administer this draft with thine own hand.
Wouldst thou avenge thyself, or the innocent maid?
Foolish woman, this medicine is potent for good. And were it my own child, I could do no better for it.
The death fiend is come. I bid thee think again, ere thou beholdest me quaff it. See, it is even now at my lips.
Drink? Dost thou know me so little, Hesperin? Hester, I ask not wherefore nor how thou hast fallen into the pit. Men call me wise. I might have seen all this. From the moment we came down the old church steps together, a married pair, I might have beheld the balefire of that scarlet letter blazing at the end of our path.
Thou knowest that I was frank with thee. I felt no love, nor feigned any.
True. It was my folly. My heart was habitation large enough for many guests, but lonely and chill without a household fire. I longed to kindle one.
I have greatly wronged you.
We have wronged each other. But after the man lives, was wrong to spoke. Who is he?
Ask me not. That thou shalt never know.
Never? Sayest thou? Never know. Believe me, Hester, there are few things hidden from the man who earnestly devotes himself to the solution of a mystery. Thou mayest keep thy secret from the prying multitude, but as for me, I shall seek this man.
Thy words interpret thee as terrible.
One thing, thou that wast my wife, I would enjoin upon thee. Thou hast kept the secret of thy parent. Keep likewise mine. There are none in this land that know me. Grieve not to any human soul that thou didst ever call me husband.
Why not announce thyself openly and cast me off at once?
'Tis my purpose to live and die unknown. Shouldst thou fail me in this, beware.
I will keep thy secret, as I have his.
Swear it. Now, Mistress Prynne, I leave thee alone. Alone with thy infant and the scarlet letter. How is it, Hester? Doth thy sentence even bind thee to wear the token in thy sleep? Art thou not afraid of nightmares and hideous dreams?
Why dost thou smile so at me? Hast thou enticed me into a bond that will prove the ruin of my soul?
Not thy soul. No, not thine.
Hush, Pearl, hush. Thou must not talk so.
There's one of the scarlet letters!
Is Governor Bellingham within?
His worship is within. He's with a godly minister right now. Ye may not see his worship.
Nevertheless, I will enter. Come along, Pearl. The governor is coming. The gentleman along with him.
What have we here? What little bird of scarlet plumage may this be? Prithee, young one, who art thou? Art thou a Christian child?
I am my mother's child. My name is Pearl.
Pearl? Ruby, judging from thy heel. But where is this mother of thine? Ah, I see. This is the selfsame child of whom we have now speech together. And behold here the unhappy woman, Hester Prynne, her mother. Hester Prynne, there have been much talk concerning thee of late. What canst thou do for the child?
I can teach my little Pearl what I have learned from this.
Woman, it is thy badge of shame. It is because of that stain that we would transfer thy child to other hands.
Nevertheless, this badge has taught me lessons, whereof my child may be the wiser and better.
We will judge fairly, and look well what we are about to do. Canst thou tell me, my child, who made thee?
I have not been made at all. I was plucked by my mother off the wild rose bush by the prison door.
This is awful. She cannot tell who made her. Methinks, gentlemen, we need inquire no further.
God gave me the child. She is my happiness. Ye shall not take her. I will die first.
My poor woman, the child shall be well cared for. Far better than thou canst do for it.
God gave me the child. I will not give her up. Speak thou for me. I will not lose the child. Look to it.
There is truth in what she says. God gave her the child. Is there not a quality of awful sacredness in the relation between this mother and this child?
Ah! How is that with Master himself? Make that complaint in my brain.
This child is father's guilt, and its mother's shame come from the hand of God to work in many ways upon her heart. Hath she not expressed this thought? And the garb of the poor child, so forcibly reminding us of the red symbol which sears her bosom.
Well said, again. I fear the woman has a very thought that will make a mountain of her child.
Not so. Not so. She recognizes the solemn miracle which God hath wrought in the existence of this child. Herein is the simple mother happier than the simple father. For Hester Prynne's sake, and no less for the poor child's sake, let us leave them as Providence has seen fit to place them.
You speak, my friend, with a strange adamantness. What say you, worshipful Master Bellingham? Hath you not pleaded well for the poor woman?
Indeed, we have to do such arguments that we shall even leave the matter as it now stands. So long, at least, as there shall be no further scandal in the woman.
Is that my Pearl?
The little baggage hath witchcraft in her.
Strange child. It is easy to see the mother's part. Would it be beyond the philosopher's research to analyze that child's nature and give a shrewd guess at the father?
Nay, it would be sinful. Better to fast and pray upon it.
Company in the forest.
I must tarry at home and keep watching for my little Pearl.
The health of Mr. Dimmesdale had evidently begun to fail.
His form grew emaciated. He was often observed, on any slight alarm,
or other sudden accident,
to place his hand over his heart, indicative of pain.
Mm.
you gather those herbs? Such a dark flavor.
I found them growing on a grave, which bore no tombstone, no other memorial of the dead man, save these ugly weeds that sprung up out of his heart to typify, it may be, a hideous secret that was buried with him, and which he had done better to confess during his lifetime.
Perchance he earnestly desired it, but could not.
And wherefore? Wherefore not? Since all the powers of nature call so earnestly for the confession of sin, that these black weeds have sprung up out of a very heart to make manifest an outspoken crime.
The heart, making itself guilty of such secrets, must perforce hold them until the day when all hidden things shall be revealed.
Then why not reveal it here?
Why would a wretched man, guilty, we will say, of murder, prefer to keep a corpse buried in his heart, rather than to fling it forth at once and let the universe take care of it?
Some men bury their secrets thus.
True, there are such men.
These men deceive themselves.
That may be so. But now, I would ask of my well-skilled physician whether, if in good sooth, he deems me to have profited from his kindly care of his weak frame of mind.
Well,
what?
His name. Is the imp altogether evil?
Whether capable of good, I know not.
Come away, Mother, she will catch you, but you cannot catch a little girl.
Is Hester friend the less miserable, thank you, for that scarlet letter on her breast?
There was a look of pain, which I would gladly have been spared the sight of. But still, methinks it must needs be better for the sufferer to be free to show his pain, as this poor woman Hester, than to cover it up in his heart.
You asked me my judgment of fetching your help.
I did, and would gladly know. Speak frankly, I pray you, be it for life or death.
The disorder is a strange one. I should deem you a man sore sick, yet not so sick, but that an instructed and watchful physician might well help to cure you. But I know not what to say. The disease is something that I seem to know, yet know it not.
You speak in riddles, learned sir.
Let me ask you, friend, under providence, of your life and physical well-being, have all the operations of this disorder been fairly laid open and recounted?
How can you question it? Surely it would be child's play to call in the physician and then hide the sore.
A bodily disease, which we look upon as whole and entire within itself, may be but a symptom of some ailment in the spiritual heart.
Then I need ask no further. You deal not, I take it, in the medicine for the soul.
Thus a sickness. Would you then the physician heal the bodily evil? But how may that be unless you first lay open to him the wound or trouble in your soul?
Not to thee. Not to an earthly physician. Not to thee. Who art thou that meddlest in this matter? That dares thrust himself between the sufferer and his God?
Seeing now how passion takes hold upon this man, and hurries him out of himself, he hath done a hot thing in the passion of his heart.
In these black garments of the priesthood. I, who ascended the sacred desk and turned my pale face heavenward. I, who have laid the hand of baptism upon your children. I, who have breathed the parting prayer over your dying friends. I, your pastor, whom you so reverence and trust, am utterly a pollution and a lie.
No. No! No! It is done. The whole town shall awake and hurry forth and find me here.
Thank you.
come you, Hester? What sent you hither?
I have been watching at Governor Winthrop's deathbed, and am now going forward to my dwelling.
Come up hither, Hester. Thou and little girl, come up hither once again, and we shall stand all three together.
Minister.
What wouldst thou say, child?
Wilt thou stay in here with mother and me tomorrow, noontime?
Nay, not so, my little girl. Not so, my child. I shall indeed stand with thy mother and thee one other day, but not tomorrow. A moment longer, my child.
But wilt thou promise to take my hand and mother's hand here tomorrow noontime?
Not then, girl, but another time.
And what other time?
On the great judgment day. Then and there, before the judgment seat, thy mother, thou, and I must stand together. But the daylight of this world shall never see our meeting. Who is that man, Hester? I shiver at him. Dost thou know the man?
Minister, I can tell thee who he is.
Quickly then, child, quickly. And as low as thou canst whisper. Dost thou mock me now?
Thou would not promise to take my hand, mother's hand, here, tomorrow, noontime.
Worthy sir, pious Master Dimmesdale, can this be you? Come, good sir and dear friend, I pray you let me lead you home.
How knowest thou that I was here?
I knew nothing of the matter. I spent the better part of the evening at the bedside of our good Governor Winthrop. It was found on the scaffold where evildoers are set up to public shame.
That seems to be my glove indeed.
Did your reverence hear of the portent that was seen this night? A great red letter in the sky. The letter A, which we interpret to stand for angel. For as our good Governor Winthrop was made an angel this night.
No, I had not heard of it.
Years had come and gone. Pearl was now 7 years old.
Her mother, with the scarlet letter,
had long become a familiar object to the townspeople.
The letter was the symbol of her calling.
Such helpfulness was found in her that many people refused to interpret the scarlet A by its original signification.
They said it meant able. So strong was Hester Prynne.
With a woman's strength.
I would speak a word with you. A word that concerns us much.
Why, mistress, I hear good tidings of you on all hands. It was debated whether or no yonder scarlet letter might be taken off your bosom.
Were I worthy to be quit of it, it would fall away of its own nature.
The letter is most gaily embroidered. It shows right bravely in your bosom. What see you in my face that you look at it so earnestly?
Something that would make me weep, if there were any tears bitter enough for it. But let it pass. It is of yonder miserable man that I would speak.
And what of him?
You tread behind his every footstep. You are beside him, sleeping and waking. Your clutch is on his life, and you cause him to die daily a living death, and still he knows you not. In permitting this, I surely acted a false part. By the only man to whom the power was left me to be true.
And what choice had you? My finger, pointed at this man, would have hurled him from his pulpit into a dungeon, thence, peradventure, to the gallows.
It had been better so!
What evil have I done the man? Oh, a goodly secret could I reveal. But enough. What art can do, I have exhausted on him. That he now breathes and creeps about the earth is owing all to me.
Better he had died at once.
Yea, woman. thou sayest truly. Better had he died at once. No mortal has ever suffered what this man has suffered. And all in the sight of his worst enemy.
Hast thou not tortured him enough? Has he not paid thee all?
No. No! He has but increased his debt. Dost thou not remember me, Hester? As I was 9 years ago? Was I not, though you might deem me cold, nevertheless, a man thoughtful for others, craving little for himself, kind, true, just, and of constant, if not warm, affections? Was I not all this?
All this and more.
What am I now? I have already told thee what I am. Fiend, who made me so.
It was I. Why hast thou not avenged thyself on me?
I have left thee to the Scarlet Letter. If that is not avenged me, I can do no more.
It has avenged thee.
I have judged no less. Now what wouldst thou with me touching this man?
I must reveal the secret. What may be the result, I know not. Do with him as thou wilt. There is no good for him. No good for me, no good for thee. There is no good for little Pearl. There is no path to guide us out of this dismal maze.
Woman, I pity thee for the good that has been wasted in thy nature.
And I thee for the hatred that has transformed a wise and just man to a fiend. Wilt thou yet purge it out of thee, and be once more human? If not for his sake, then doubly for thine own. Forgive, and leave his further retribution to the power that claims it. There might be good for thee, and thee alone, since thou hast been deeply wronged, and hast it at thy will to pardon. Wilt thou give up that only privilege? Wilt thou reject that priceless benefit?
Peace, Hester, peace! It is not granted me to pardon. I have no such power as thou tellest me of. Thou that have wronged me are not sinful, neither am I fiend-like. It is our fate. Let the black flower blossom as it may. Now go thy way, and deal as thou wilt with yonder man.
Be it sin or no, I hate the man. Yes, I hate him. He betrayed me. He has done me worse wrong than I did him. Pearl? Little Purple? Where are you?
I wonder if Mother will ask me what it means.
My little Pearl. Dost thou know what this letter means?
Yes, Mother. It is Scarlet Letter A.
Dost thou know wherefore thy mother wears this letter?
For the same reason the minister keeps his hand on his heart.
And what reason is that?
I have told you all I know. What does the Scarlet Letter mean, Mother? And why dost thou wear it? And why does the minister keep his hand over his heart?
Silly Pearl, what questions are these? There are many things in the world that a child must not ask about. What know I of the minister's heart? And as for the Scarlet Letter, I wear it for the sake of its gold thread.
Mother, what does the Scarlet Letter mean? Mother, Mother! Why does the minister keep his hand on his heart?
Hold thy tongue, naughty child. Do not tease me, else I shall put thee into the dark closet. Pearl, I hear a footstep along the path. Leave me to speak with him that comes yonder. But do not stray far. Arthur Dimmesdale. Arthur Dimmesdale.
Who speaks? Hester, is it thou? Art thou in life?
In such a life as has been mine these
7 years pass. And thou, Arthur Dimmesdale, dost thou yet live?
Master, hast thou found peace?
Hast thou?
None. Nothing but despair. What else can I look for, being what I am and leading such a life as mine? Master, I am most miserable.
The people reverence thee. Doth this bring thee no comfort?
More misery, Hester. Only the more misery. I laugh at the contrast between what I seem and what I am, and Satan laughs at it.
Your sin is left behind you in the days long past.
What mean you?
Oh, Arthur, forgive me. That old man, the physician, he whom they call Roger Chillingworth, he was my husband.
I might have known it. I did know it. Why did I not understand? Oh, Hester, thou little knowest all the horror of this thing and the shame. I cannot forgive thee.
Thou shalt forgive me. Let God punish. Thou shalt forgive. Wilt thou forgive?
I do forgive you, Hester. May God forgive us. Hester, Roger Chillingworth knows your purpose to reveal his true character. Will he continue then to keep our secret? What will not be the course of his revenge?
I deem it not likely that he will betray the secret.
And I? How am I to live longer, breathing the same air as this deadly enemy? For me, Hester, thou art strong. Resolve for me.
Thou must dwell no longer with this man.
But how to avoid it? What choice remains to me? And be thou strong for me. Advise me what to do.
Is the world then so narrow? There is the broad pathway of the sea.
I am powerless to go.
Leave this wreck and ruin here where it hath happened. Meddle no more with it. Begin all anew. Give up this name of Arthur Dimmesdale, and make thyself another, and a high one, such as thou canst wear without fear or shame.
Oh, Hester, there is not the strength nor courage left in me to venture into the wide, strange, difficult world alone.
Thou shalt not go alone.
Do I feel joy again? Oh, Hester, thou art my dear angel. This is already a better life. Why did we not find it sooner?
Let us not look back. The past is gone. Wherefore shall we linger upon it now? See, with this symbol, I undo it all and make it as if it had never been. Thou must know Pearl, our little Pearl. Thou hast seen her, yes, I know it, but thou wilt see her now with other eyes. She is a strange child. I hardly comprehend her. But thou wilt love her dearly, as I do, and wilt advise me how to deal with her.
Dost thou think the child will be glad to know me? I have even been afraid of little Pearl.
She will love thee dearly, and thou her. She is not far off. I will call her. Pearl! Pearl!
I see the child. Yonder she is, standing in a streak of sunshine, a good way off on the other side of the brook. So, thou thinkest the child will love me?
Thou will love her dearly. Doth thou think her beautiful? She is a splendid child, but I know whose brow she has.
Dost thou know, Hester, that this child will cost me many and a warmth? Methought, oh, Hester, what a thought it is, and how terrible to dread it. That my features were partly repeated in her face, and so strikingly that the world might see them. But she is mostly thine.
No, no. Not mostly. A little longer, and one needs not to be afraid to trace whose child she is. She loves me, and will love thee.
Children are not readily wont to be familiar with me. They will not climb my knee, nor prattle my ear, nor answer my smile.
She may be strange and shy at first, but will soon learn to love me.
Come, dearest child. How slow thou art. Here is a friend of mine who must be thy friend also. Leap across the brook and come to us. Thou canst leap like a young deer. Thou strange child, why dost thou not come to me? Hasten, Pearl, or else I shall be angry with thee. Leap across the brook, naughty child, and come to us. Else I must come to thee. I can't help the child. Pearl misses something that she has always been aware.
I pray you acknowledge any means of pacifying.
Pearl, look down at thy feet. There, before thee, on the hither side of the brook. Bring it hither.
Come now and take it up.
Was ever such a child? Oh, I have much to tell thee about her. Dost thou know thy mother now, child? Will thou come across the brook and own thy mother? Now that she has her shame upon her? Now that she is sad?
Yes, now I will. Now thou art my mother indeed, and I'm thy little Pearl. And
that was not kind. When thou hast shown me a little love, thou mockest me.
Why doth the minister sit yonder?
He waits to welcome thee. Come thou and entreat his blessing. He loves thee, my little girl, and loves thy mother too. Wilt thou not love him? Come, he longs to greet thee.
Doth he love us? Will he come back with us, we three together, hand in hand into the town?
Not now, my child. But in days to come, he will walk hand in hand with us. We will have a home and fireside of our own. And thou shalt sit upon his knee, and he will teach thee many things and love thee dearly. Thou wilt love him, wilt thou not?
And will he always keep his hand over his heart?
Foolish child, what a question is that? Come and ask his blessing.
And turns thy pale face heavenward.
Thou who hast laid the hand of baptism upon my children.
Thou who hast breathed parting prayer over my dying friend.
Thou who I so reverence and trust.
Thou art utterly a pollution and a lie. Black garment.
Sacred death. Pale face.
Black garment.
Sacred death. Pale face.
Black garment.
Sacred death. Pale face.
I am utterly a pollution and a lie. Is it that haunts and tempts me thus? Am I mad?
So, Reverend Dimmesdale, you have made a visit into the forest. I pray you the next time only to allow me a fair warning, and I shall be proud to bear you company.
My one sufficient object was to greet that pious friend of mine, the Apostle Elliot, to rejoice with him over the many precious souls he had won from heathen.
Well, well, we must needs talk thus in the daytime. But at midnight, and in the forest, We shall have other talk together.
Have I then sold myself to the fiend?
Welcome home, Reverend Sir. Will not my aid be requisite to put you in heart and strength to preach your election, sir?
Nay, I think to need no more of your drugs.
Yes, sir. We must take pains to make you strong and vigorous for this occasion of election discourse. Your people look for great things from you, apprehending that another year may come about and find their pastor gone.
Yes, to another world, having granted me a better one. A touch of your medicine, kind sir, in my present frame of body, I need it.
I joy to hear it. It may be that my remedies begin now to take due effect.
I thank you from the heart, most watchful friend.
Betimes in the morning of the day where the new governor was to receive his office at the hands of the people, Hester Prynne and her little Pearl came into the marketplace.
It was already thronged with inhabitants of the town, in considerable numbers.
Well, what is this, Mother? Wherefore have all the people come to the marketplace today? Is it a play day for the whole world? What do they come to do here at the marketplace?
They wait to see the procession pass, for the governor and the magistrates are to go by.
And will the minister be there? And will he hold out both hands to me, as when thou ledst me to him from the brookside?
He will be there, child, but he will not greet thee today, nor wilt thou greet him.
What a strange, sad man he is, with his hand always over his heart.
Be quiet, Pearl. Thou understandest not these things. Think not now of the minister, but look about thee, and see how cheery they are in his face today. They make merry and rejoice, as if a good and golden year were at length to pass over this poor old world.
Mistress, I must be a steward, make ready one more birthday you bargained for.
What mean you?
You must have known it, for he tells me he is of your party. Reverend Dimsdale to deliver his election sermon.
Mother, was that the same minister that kissed me by the brook?
Hold thy peace, dear little girl. We must not always talk in the marketplace of what happens to us in the forest.
I could not be sure it was he, so strange he looked.
Well for thee, foolish child, that thou didst not speak to him.
Psst. What mortal imagination can conceive it? Yonder divine man, that saint on earth, who now? That saw him pass in the procession, would think, how little while it is since he went forth out of his study to take an airing in the forest. Couldst thou tell whether he was the same man who encountered thee on the forest path?
Madam, I know not of what you speak.
Fie, woman, fie! Dost thou think that I have been to the forest so many times and have yet no skill to judge who else has been there? Reverend Mr. Dimsdale, he hath a way of ordering matters so that the mark shall be disclosed in open daylight to the eyes of all the world. What is that that the minister seeks to hide with his hand always over his heart? Huh? Hester Prynne?
Hast thou seen it?
Thou thyself wilt see it, one time or another. Thou shalt know wherefore the minister keeps his hand over his heart.
Thy mother yonder was with the scarlet letter.
Will thou carry her message from me?
If the message pleases me, I will.
Then tell her that I spake again with the hump-shouldered old doctor, and he engages to bring his friend with him, the gentleman she abhors at Watson. Will you carry this message for me?
It's the woman with the scarlet letter. She's here in the marketplace.
Hester, come hither. Come, my little girl.
What is your purpose? Wave off this woman, cast off this child. Won't you break infamy on your sacred profession?
Thy power is not what it was. With God's help, I shall escape thee now. Hester, in the name of him, so terrible and so merciful, who gives me grace at this last moment to do what I withheld myself from doing 7 years ago. Twine thy strength about me, thy strength, Hester, but let it be guided by the will which God hath granted me. Come, Hester, come, support me up yonder scaffold.
Hast thou sought the whole earth over? There is no one place so secret where thou couldst have escaped me, save on this very scaffold.
Thanks be to him who hath led me hither. Is not this better than what we dreamed of in the forest?
I know not. Better, yea, so that we may both die, and little Pearl die with us.
For thee, little Pearl, be it as God shall order, and God is merciful. Let me now do the will which he hath made plain before my sight, Professor. I am a dying man, so let me make haste and take my shame upon me. People of New England! Ye that have loved me, ye that have deemed me holy, behold me here, the one sinner of the world! At last I stand upon this spot where 7 years since I should have stood, here with this woman. Lo, the scarlet letter which Hester wears, ye have all shuddered at it. It was on him. Now, at the death hour, he stands up before you. He bids you look again at Hester's scarlet letter. He tells you that it is but a shadow of what he bears on his own breast.
Thou hast escaped me! Thou hast escaped me!
May God forgive thee. Ye too have deeply sinned. I would you grow up with human joy and sorrow, nor forever do battle with the world, but be a woman in it. Hester, farewell.
Shall we not meet again? Shall we not spend our mortal lives together?
Hester, the law we broke, the sin he awfully revealed, let these alone be in thy thoughts. I fear. It may be that when we forgot our God, when we violated our reverence each for the other's soul, it was thenceforth vain to hope that we can meet hereafter in an everlasting and pure reunion. His will be done. Farewell.
Time sufficed for the people to gather their thoughts. There was more than one account at what had been witnessed on the scaffold.
Most of the spectators testified to having seen on the breast of the unhappy minister a scarlet letter imprinted in the flesh.
Certain persons who were spectators to the whole scene denied that there was any mark whatever upon his breast.
After exhausting his life in his efforts for mankind's spiritual good, Reverend Dimmesdale had made the manner of his death apparent.
In order to impress on his admirers the mighty and mournful lesson,
we are sinners, all alike.
The authority we have followed, chiefly followed, manuscript followed from those of old date, drawn from the verbal testimony of individuals.
Some of whom had known Hester Prynne, while others had heard from contemporary witnesses.
At old Roger Chillingworth's decease, he bequeathed a considerable amount of property.
Both here and in England, to little Pearl, the daughter of Hester Prynne.
So Pearl,
the elf child,
the demon offspring,
became the richest heiress of her day.
Had the mother and child remained here, little Pearl, at a marriageable period, might have mingled her wild blood with the lineage of the devoutest Puritan. But the wearer of the scarlet letter disappeared, and Pearl along with her.
The story of the Scarlet Letter grew into a legend.
After many, many years, a new grave was delved. It bore a device, a herald's wording, which might serve for her motto. On a field,
sable, the letter A, Q's.